Okay, you ready to start, Mr. Rigby? Okay, again, last week we studied and are studying the book of Galatians, and last week we were studying about the law brings a curse. And I want to tell you, the law brings a curse for everyone. You cannot participate in the law and be under the law and not be under a curse. Even Jesus was cursed before he hung on the cross being under the law. Jesus was under Roman occupation. And last week, man, I said a lot of misquoting words. I said he was like a Roman citizen, and you caught it, and I didn't recognize. No, Jesus was not a Roman citizen, but he was under Roman occupation. So I'm glad I remembered that. And that was one of the things that was listed as the curse, if you didn't keep the law completely. We also noticed, proven that if just one person in all of Israel broke the covenant, the whole nation suffered. And that it was a corporate suffering. That's why Jesus, keeping the law perfectly, still suffered under the law, because the whole group of people were under a curse. Yet God protected Jesus while he's under that curse, such as, you know, he didn't get any sickness or disease. He never had lack for money. You know, some people say Jesus was poor. I don't find that in Scripture. He always had enough to meet his needs, even if he got it from a fish, right? You mentioned that he had to pay the temple tax. Well, how cool it would be for you anytime you had a need, you just like, you know, pull out your wallet, you go to the store, I have no money going into the store, I open up my wallet and there's money in my wallet, you know. I'm not implying God would counterfeit money, you know, but let's just say you go to the store and God would bring somebody in right behind you and they give you $100 bill and your grocery bill was $94. I'm dating myself, huh? It'd be $294. Okay, so Jesus was under a curse. We are under a curse. So if you are in a church or a belief system that you have to obey the law, if you do that, you will be under a curse. And that church could be under a curse and still being blessed, still being taken care of. But there's all these situations, all these circumstances happening to the church because the church is under a curse. But the individuals could be blessed from it. But do you remember a question? You don't have to answer, but do you remember when we talked about the sins of the pastor falling down onto the congregation? So if a pastor's like caught up in sexual immorality, so many people in that church are getting divorced and having issues like that. If a pastor is caught up in legalism, so many people are having affairs and they end up like suicide. If you're teaching psychology, even Christian psychology, so many people get caught up in that carnal wisdom. So as the pastor leads, the congregation has a tendency to follow. So this week we're moving on. And we're going to talk about the promises of Abraham. Because remember, I mentioned last week that Jesus redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. And he did that through his death, burial, and resurrection. But so that we could have what? So that we could have the promises of Abraham. We also discussed that. But we're going to in-depth discuss it today, that the promises made to God were made 430 years to Abraham before Moses. This covenant God made, he made to Abraham to be a a never-ending covenant to be to her, his descendants and all those after him that followed and believed in that. And the second covenant didn't annul the first. Okay, so that's what we're going to be talking now, is we as Christians are under the Mosaic covenant.
No.
Thank you. We are under the Abrahamic covenant. Man, if I could control my tongue, that would be perfect, right? But I got you guys to help. Thank you. So Galatians chapter 3, for when we, those of us that got our Bibles, those of us don't, I will post this on Facebook. It's not there now, these study notes, where you can follow along before I post this. But you can look for Galatians part 10, the changeless promise, and look at those study notes, and you can follow along. Galatians chapter 3, verses 15 through 18. Now, the question, you don't have, does anyone want to read? Does that involve a question, or you just want me to read?
Read.
Okay, would you read nice and loud for everyone?
Brethren, I speak in the manner of men, though it is only a man's covenant, yet it is confirmed. No one annuls or adds to it. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say, and to seeds as of many, but of one, and to your seed, who is Christ. And this I say, that the law, which was 430 years later, cannot annul the covenant that was confirmed before by God in Christ, that it should make the promise of no effect. For if the inheritance is of the law, it is no longer of promise, but God gave it to Abraham by promise.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Bless your word. Good job. I don't know about you, you know, but you start marking in your Bible, and it's all marked. Every line's marked. It's like, it becomes a point, because it's all such good word. Okay, so this week I want to kind of go on this real slowly, not preaching, but really methodically, verse by verse on here. Okay? So, again, verse 15. Now, we read 15 through 18, okay, and it's talking about the promises of God. They're chainless, meaning if they were made back then, they haven't changed. They're still for us today. Okay, so verse 15, now you'll notice on your paper, I actually have the verse in case, so we don't have to go back and forth on our thing. So verse 15 says, brethren, I speak in the manner of men, though it is only a man's covenant, yet if it is confirmed, no one annuls or adds to it. So did you guys realize, I got to make an example, that like when you make a will and a testament, you can amend or modify it as you wish until it is confirmed, ratified, or validated. Now, once done, it is binding and cannot be invalidated or added to. So, an example one might ask, well, how do you, come on, John, people make will and testament and they add people to it and they take it away. Well, what confirms, ratifies, and validates a will? A human being's will that they're going to leave their inheritance to the children. How is it confirmed, ratified, and validated to the point that it cannot be changed? One is you have a lawyer to do it, that he can verify that you're of sound mind and that all the legal aspects have done that. It couldn't be It could be disputed because you used the wrong words. But even if you don't get a lawyer, you can make your own will and testament. And you have to somehow prove some way that you're of sound mind, that you're not being coerced. Somebody's not holding a gun to your head to give them your inheritance versus your children. And validated. This is a valid a will and testament. It's not written on a napkin. It wasn't somebody that somebody told you on a date. You know, a woman went out with this man and he said, well, I'll give you everything. And, you know, you were gone. That's not validated. Okay? It's not valid. So you have to have valid legal documentation. But it can always be added to or modified until when?
Until you die.
Until you die. So one of the ways that it is confirmed is all these P's and Q's were met. Okay? Everything was, and you died. But if you didn't die, it could be added. Christ died, my friend. Christ died and fulfilled this covenant. Jesus, our Christ, let's just say, Jesus died. The Lamb of God died. He redeemed us from the curse of the law. Now we're not under the law anymore. We're now under what? The Abrahamic covenant. So we're going to start looking at the Abrahamic covenant. So with God's covenant to Abraham, there's no question the promises he made to Abraham and his seed would be kept. And kept exactly as promised. Because he made it between himself and Abraham. I lost my place. I had to make the smaller print. Between himself and Abraham. A covenant that was not dependent upon Abraham's actions in any way. In other words, Abraham offered nothing to this covenant. Nor was he required to do anything to maintain it. However, no one is able to receive all the promises made to Abraham until Jesus died as the Lamb of God. Now, you know, there's certain conditions I can make in a will and a testament. I could say, hey, I'm going to give my daughter or my son or somebody, I'm going to give them two-thirds of my inheritance, of all my stuff. But they got to go to college first. They got to graduate with a certain grade point. They got to be married by age 28 or 30. They can never get divorced. I could put all kinds of things in there, right? So if that person doesn't do it, they lose their money, right? We've even watched movies, haven't we, where a guy has to get married or he loses, you know, his inheritance and he's got like a week to do it and he's got to fall in love, right? But God didn't tell Abraham he had to do one thing. So could Abraham screw this up? Because God made the promise to Abraham. Now, all our Bible scholars out here, we know that Abraham did some pretty disgusting things, right? Does, if anyone wants to put a comment out, feel free. But one of the things I know that was really disgusting, I think, is that when Abraham would offer up his wife to be a king, a ruler, Pharaoh at one time, and then another king. So he did it twice. He offered up his wife to be their wife, go into the be part of their harem, be concubines or whatever. He offered their wife to go have sex with somebody else.
Supposedly to save his own. And he was supposed to cover her.
Yes. He did that supposedly to save his own life instead of her life. Now, I'm sorry, man. If my brother did that, I would say, brother, you're a wimp. If anybody else did that, I would say, you don't love your wife at all. She should leave you. But God made a covenant and he honored Abraham. And guess who got punished? The kings, both in both references, Pharaoh and the other and the king, they both got in trouble. They both got reprimanded. Not Abraham. Not God never even said a bad word to him. God never even said, Abraham, man, how long am I going to deal with you? Not one word of correction. So, let's go to Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 through 7. I'll be reading out of the New King James. Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 through 7. And when Abraham was 99 years old, how old? 99. The Lord, that's pretty old, man. The Lord appeared to Abraham and said to him, I am Almighty God. Walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my covenant between me and you, and will multiply you exceedingly. What's, maybe put this in your comment. Well, how was God going? What was part of this covenant? What was part of the benefits of this covenant? That you would be multiplied exceedingly. Then Abraham fell on his face and God talked to him, saying, as for me, behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be a father of many nations. Did God say, and your covenant will be with me? Enter into this agreement, your covenant will be with me. No, God said, my covenant will be with you, and you're going to be the father of many nations. Abraham really had very little choice in this matter. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be called Abraham. For I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. And I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your descendants after you, in their generations, for an everlasting covenant. How long is an everlasting covenant? Everlasting. It never stops. That's why Paul says, even though this covenant is written 430 years before the Mosaic covenant, this covenant never stopped. But it kind of like put a stumbling block in it. It kind of like when they went into the Mosaic covenant, they refused. The Israelites were led out of Egypt into Canaan, Mount Sinai. Okay, and God told Moses, hey, this is the sign I'm going to give you, Moses, that you're going to come and worship me on this mountain. And everything's going to be great, man. I'm going to tell on a fellowship with my people. And guess what? They get to that mountain, God talks to the people, and the people stop up their ears. Remember? We talked about that? They didn't want to hear God's voice. And they told Abraham, no, Abraham, we don't want the blessings of God. You tell us what to do, and we'll do it. We'll get it. You convince God to bless us on our behalf, but we're good enough just as we are to go do this. Okay.
I have one question.
What's that?
In the first part of this verse, though, and obviously maybe it means something else, because when he says, I am Almighty God, walk before me and be blameless.
Yes.
Was that part of the covenant that he had to be blameless? Because to me, I take that as, you know, don't sin, don't, you know, stuff like that. But it doesn't mean something else? Or?
So you're saying... This, what I'm hearing you saying is, to be part of this covenant, you have to walk before me and not commit in any sin.
Right, and be blameless.
Okay. No. He's saying, you walk before me and be blameless. God's pronouncing, you're blameless to come before me. Because we cannot enter the Holy of Holies. We cannot enter into the presence of God unless we're blameless. So God is talking to Abraham. He hasn't put any point of what this covenant is going to be. God is saying, Nancy, or Dez, or Bob, or anybody else out there, he's saying, walk before me and be blameless. God pronounced Abram at this time, blameless.
Or you will be blameless.
He didn't say, you will be blameless.
No, but
you had to be blameless. He said, and be, present tense, mm-hmm. blameless. Does that answer? Does that make any sense?
Yes.
Because how Abraham able to prove it? I mean, God makes this covenant to him right then and there. So what if Abraham wasn't blameless the next day? God already made it. Oops. Sorry, God. I got your blood, your covenant. You said it's going to happen. I'm just going to go worship Satan now. You gave all your power and authority to Satan. No, God says you're blameless. Now, does blameless mean he was a new creation?
No.
Does blameless mean he had the Holy Spirit in his dwelling in him? No, it doesn't. But it does mean that he was no accusation. You know, you go through a court and there's no evidence, you're blameless. It doesn't mean you didn't do anything wrong. It just meant nobody could put blame on you. Nobody can accuse you. Very good point, but I like it when we catch these words, because these words is what makes it different. Okay, we were going to verse 7, so, and the very last part of verse 7 is, let me reread verse 7 again. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your descendants after you in this generation, in their generation, for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and your descendants after you. So what is the other part of this covenant? God's going to greatly multiply you, and he's going to be God. How awesome is it is to God be our God? How awesome is it for the creator of heaven and earth to be your God? How terrible is it to have been a Canaanite whose God was Moloch? Who God was a demon? Who God who had limitations? But we have the God that could do all things, the God that spoke the world into existence. Okay, we didn't stop there. We went right into Hebrews chapter 9, verse 17. So, it should be there. It's a small verse. If you get it in it, you guys have got it on your...
Yes.
You got it before me?
Yeah.
Hebrews 9:17. Dev, would you like to read that?
For a testament is in force after men are dead, since it has no power at all while the testator lives.
Okay. So, does the covenant that God made with Abraham, did it have any power before Christ was the Lamb of God?
Say again.
The covenant that God made between himself and Abraham and Abraham's descendants, that he would be the father of many nations, people groups, was there any power in that covenant until after Jesus died?
No.
According to you, thank you, you didn't have to answer, but thank you for answering. That's correct. No, it didn't have a power until it is confirmed, ratified, or verified. It always could be changed, or you don't have any power until, if your parents give you a will and testament, until they die, you don't get anything. Until Jesus died, until the Lamb of God was the sacrifice and redeemed us from the curse of the law, Abraham's descendants were under a curse, not a blessing. They weren't being multiplied. There were a few people.
Well, they were being multiplied because it started off with just Abraham and Sarah. They were small when they went into Egypt, but they were mighty when they came out. So they
then
were multiplied.
Then they were made
multiplied.
Small, yes, but then they made small again before they went into the promised land.
Yeah.
And then they grow and they multiply and then they get all wiped out. Just a small remnant. You know, and it always this remnant kind of implies about 6%, 10% of the people were saved, okay, out of all this. But now, when it comes to the timeless promise of Abraham, now when Jesus died, he has set who free? He set us free from the bondage of sin, set us free from the curse of the law, and now it's multiplying. You know how many people are Christians today? Right now? I don't know. But there's a lot more people alive today that are born again Christians than were on the face of the earth when Abraham walked the earth. Okay? So that it is just exponentially multiplying. That Abraham's descendants are the seed, that one seed, Christ. And when it happened. But what does this have to do, guys, with the blessings of Abraham, the promises of Abraham, the favor of Abraham? I'm going to tell you, God called Abraham blameless. God wants to pour out his blessings on blameless people. And you're a Christian, you are blameless. The word of God, God says in Jude that he is able to present you perfect before God. You are without sin. You cannot be separated. Your spirit is holy and true. We sang a song today at your dwelling place, right? That God lives inside us, right? You know, one of the things about Passover before that, what you had to do is, what we do it now for the Day of Atonement, not Passover, but you had to go through all the corners of your house and sweep out and look for any leaven that might be there, because leaven represented sin. You had to be completely, your dwelling had to be completely sinless. Your dwelling had to be completely sinless before God could enter into that dwelling. So if God lives in my dwelling, is it sinless?
Yes.
You don't have to answer, but thank you. Yes, my dwelling is sinless or God couldn't live in it. That's an amazing statement. That song just totally set me free. I don't know how it did to you, but when we were singing it, it's like, yes, God, I am completely sinless. My dwelling place is cleansed of all imperfection. No disease, no sickness, no evil thoughts. And yet, I'm going to wake up tomorrow hurting, maybe feet hurting, maybe my wife hurting, maybe somebody else asking for prayer, maybe fighting sickness and disease. Maybe I'll get like a cold coming on to me and I'll have to fight it and fight it and fight it and preach the word. You know? But that's this corrupt, this flesh. It's not the spiritual. It's not the spirit being. Myself, where God dwells, is perfect. Okay? And I live in a body of corruption. I go to the bathroom and it stinks. You know? My fingernails fall off. My hair falls out. I get cuts and bruises. You know? If I don't brush my teeth, I get bad breath. That's getting bad. I put myself down. Let's get back. The Bible says I am perfect. And people say, no, you're not perfect. Well, if I wasn't perfect, God couldn't live inside me. And God said before, God, if I don't leave, it's beneficial that I leave, because if I don't leave, the Holy Spirit won't come. And he also said, you know, the Holy Spirit was among you, but now he'll live inside you. I'm perfect and holy because if I wasn't, the Holy Spirit couldn't live inside me. Back at verse 16, Galatians chapter 3, verse 16. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say, and to seeds as of many, but... He does not say, I'm going to start over. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say, and to seeds as of many, but as of one, and to your seed who is Christ. Now I want you to notice he said promises, right? So we have promises made before Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. We have promises made after Christ's death, burial, and resurrection that were made to Abraham. The promise that all nations would be blessed through Abraham's seed has been accomplished in Christ Jesus and to your seed, the one seed of promise, making Christians the sons, plural, of promise through Christ. Again, this gift was not granted because of genealogy, but by the faith of Christ. So Paul did not, used to be called, referred to as Saul, he did not have salvation because he was of the tribe of Benjamin, because he was a Pharisee, because he studied the word, because he was a Jew. He did not have these promises. He didn't have security in heaven, although he thought he did. But when he realized his security, his invitation to come to the wedding feast, him being the bride of Christ, was accomplished through the seed of Christ, who was Jesus, and it also says it's through the faith of Jesus, not faith in Jesus. Okay? So, Romans 2:29, New King James, but he is a Jew who is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, not in the letter, whose praise is not from men, but God. So you're not a Jew if your genealogy says you're a Jew. Paul, back was referred to Saul, was not a Jew. But he says, I'm of the tribe of Benjamin. I'm pure blood. God says he wasn't a Jew. Until when? Until he had a circumcision of the heart. You know, the Bible says I'm a Jew. And as far as I know, our genealogy is a mixed American English and some other things. Like some people say, on grandma's side might even have some Indian in us, and our grandpa's side of dad. And then grandma's like Scottish or
what's French.
No, grandma on
dad's
side.
Dad's side, yeah, they're Scottish.
Scottish,
on dad's
side. What's Campbell?
Yeah, I don't know. On dad's side, we are a mixture of all kinds of stuff.
Yeah, but I don't think we have any Jewish blood in this, right?
No.
Nothing. I mean, it goes back, and you know, we could have some far, because as you keep going back, you go back.
Everybody goes back.
Everybody goes back to Noah, you know, so. But really, I'm a Jew, and my next door neighbor who's Jewish, but genial, is not a Jew. Because the Word of God says in Romans 2:29 that he is a Jew, not one inwardly, and circumcised, that is of the heart, okay, in spirit, not in the letter, whose praise is not of God, but of men. I didn't read that. That doesn't sound right. But he is a Jew who is one inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, not in the letter, whose praise is not from men, but but from God. So he is a Jew. So you can imply he is not a Jew who doesn't that, but he is a Jew who is one inwardly, who does have a circumcision of the heart. So if you're not...
But they weren't talking, God was, that wasn't talking about a circumcision of the heart.
What wasn't?
The covenant.
Abraham entered into one of the signs that Abraham made before he got this covenant that we just read was that he would be circumcised. And that is the sign that you're a Jew.
The
circumcision of
the
flesh.
The penis.
Yes. Yes.
Question then.
Yes.
That's for men, but what if a woman's a Jew? How does she fall under the Abrahamic covenant? Is there something that Jewish women have to do?
No, they have to be married. They were by that. Now, if they didn't have,
in other words, if they are part of the covenant, is there a circumcision they must do?
No, because they are under their father who had the circumcision,
mm-hmm.
Okay? And the covenant was to Abraham, his descendants, and those after. So the females were under that. But they got married to another Jewish man. That's why they weren't supposed to marry women. Jewish women were not supposed to marry non-Jewish men. Jewish men could marry non-Jewish women, okay, unless you were Levite. But Jewish women were not to marry non-Jewish men, okay? Because if they did, they didn't have any inheritance in Israel, okay? But if I should have put back Romans 2:28, for he is not a Jew. Who is one outwardly, nor is circumcision that which is outwardly in the flesh. 29. But he is a Jew who is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit, not in the letter, whose praise is not from men, but from God. So what made you part of this Abrahamic covenant, the second Abrahamic covenant, is circumcision of the heart. That's what made a Jew. You were a Jew. A circumcision of the heart. So a lot of these groups that are going out, we're calling Messianic Jews, okay? They're really trying to incorporate the law. They're really kind of going against what Paul was saying. And most of them, when they teach, will not teach out of the book of Galatians, or will not teach this, because Paul is basically coming and saying, all your roots and heritage are as rags or dung. You're not of the promise of Abraham to receive the Spirit that God made the covenant with Abraham, unless you have a circumcision of the heart. Through that one seed, not to many seeds, that one seed, Christ Jesus. Okay, again, this gift was not granted because of genealogy, but by the faith of Christ. Realizing without Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, there would be no way of establishing this covenant to Abraham's and his descendants. So this covenant that we, you notice I put there, Genesis 17:7 again, just so we could read it again. Without Jesus dying, it would be impossible for this covenant to happen. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your descendants after you in their generation for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your descendants. God could not be your God if Jesus did not die, if Jesus did not come and make it possible for him to be your dwelling place. God could not have fellowship with you in that way. It required Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection for this covenant to be made. Just as we studied, a will and a covenant cannot be, you don't get benefit from it until somebody dies, so it can never be changed. That's why the Mosaic covenant got changed, because there was no death of a human required. It was a thing of, you do this, you get this blessing. You don't do this, you get this curse. It could never be an everlasting covenant because it was not contingent upon someone's death.
Except for Jesus's.
I was referring to the Mosaic covenant. Could not have been an everlasting covenant. The Mosaic,
Moses's.
The Mosaic covenant. Because there was no Lamb of God. There was no death. There was nothing contingent upon the death of Christ. But with the death of Christ, it is impossible for it to be changed. Nevertheless, okay, so Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection came. Now that covenant is ratified, validated, confirmed. Okay, Jesus has redeemed us from the curse of the law. There's, how come everybody's not saved? So I wrote in here in my notes, halfway through the second paragraph, you'll pick it up. Nevertheless, those born of God are in Christ and act like Christ because they have the seed of Christ and have received the promise of Abraham, which is the spirit of promise. So we have this inward circumcision. We have a circumcision of the heart and the spirit. And what happens when that? We act like Christ. We are like Christ. And this is how we look at 1 John 3:9, where every time I preach this, people will say, well, people are going to hear this and they're going to think something different. 1 John 3:9 says, whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he has been born of God. Okay, because Jesus died, we've been redeemed from the law, we now go back into that Abrahamic covenant, and we're blameless. God pronounces blameless, thus you're blameless. Now here we're blameless, we said, because we have the seed of Christ. That word sin. Now, I'm saying this for people's benefit out there. I think this verse could be better understood by saying one of the definitions of sin is not to be part of. See, the most predominant, if you open up your dictionary, right, and you look up roller skate, or you look up cigarette, or you look up damn, or you look up any word, the most commonly used way that word's used is the very first definition, right? But there might be like five definitions of what that one word says. Well, you know, in the 1600s, when this was translated into English and into King James, that the most predominant use of the word sin was to err, to miss the mark, to not be a part of. And lastly, it was to violate God's law. We, when we say sin, the very first thing we think of is violating God's law. But when they wrote it, that was the least used term of sin. So if we read this in context, whoever has been born of God does not never have a part in. It'll be a double negative. Whoever's been born of God always has a part of God because God's seed is in him and he remains in him. And he cannot sin, he cannot be separated from God because he's been born of God. Now that's a whole lot better than sitting there saying, well, you never lie, cuss, or chew, or go out with those who do, and you're a Christian. It's saying you are into the Abrahamic covenant. God has called you blameless because God can say you're blameless. God called Abraham blameless, and Abraham was not a good guy. I'm sorry. Abraham, I know you're listening. Hey, you know what? What you did was pretty bad. Okay? But God called you blameless. Therefore, you are blameless. I am blameless. Now, we got a lot of reasons that the blood cleanses us of all sins, right? The word washes us of all unrighteousness. So are we blameless?
Yeah.
Absolutely. But that word doesn't say that we don't do things wrong. It says that we can never not be a part of the Abrahamic covenant. Because God established it. It has nothing to do with you. You cannot be good enough to be saved. You just have to receive the blessing. I receive Jesus as the propitiation of my sins. I receive that Jesus died on the cross so I don't have to. I receive that Jesus was whipped and beaten and scourged so I don't have to be sick. I receive that Jesus suffered so I don't have to suffer. I receive that Jesus became poor so I could become rich. All I have to do is receive the blessings of God, not ask for the blessings of God, not beg for the blessings of God, and not try to be good enough for the blessings of God that He has already called His descendants. It might be beneficial, okay, it might be a benefit if you recognize this is the reason people were called Christians in the first place. Because they acted like Christ. So you're going to act like Christ because Christ's seed is in you. Now, that's why people in Antioch, they were called Christians. Why were they called Christians? Because they act like Christians, you know? You're a follower of that Christ guy. You're walking around casting out demons. You're walking around raising the dead. You're walking around, other people get sick, you get sick, you get healed. There's no leopards among you. You act like Christ. Moreover, we need to proclaim the scriptures like, as Christ is, so are we in this world. You know, this our church is doing more harm than Christians, than the devil. God wants to tell you, you're just a pitiful loser. You will get a new body. You will be perfect. You will be like Christ when you die and go to heaven. We need to start proclaiming the scriptures that say, as Christ is, right now, so am I in this world. Well, John, where can you say that? Well, we're going to read it later, but it's 1 John 4:17. You guys, it's right in the Bible. Okay? Now, this mindset will help you understand you do everything through Christ, and without Christ, you could do nothing. And anything done without faith is sin, and Christians cannot sin. Christians cannot sin, and anything done outside of faith is sin. So Christians cannot be separated from God, and anything done outside of faith, you're separated from God. I don't care if you have Habitat for Humanity, you feed all the homeless, you find a cure for AIDS. Anything done outside of faith is sin, separation from God. Let's look at Philippians. I had this conversation with somebody before. Well, what do you mean anything outside done out of faith is sin? Well, what if you weren't under the law? You know, were you under sin? No, it means you were separated from God. Outside of faith, you're separated from God. But in Christ, you can do all things. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. How much is all? All. Do you have financial problems? You can do all things through Christ. You cannot have financial problems through Christ. Do you have sickness? You can do all things. things. You can be overcome. You can overcome that sickness through Christ. 1 Corinthians 12:12. As the body is one and has many members, but all the members of the one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. Christ is one body. We look at the church and we say there's a whole bunch of different people in the church. You got the teachers, you got the pastors, you got the evangelists, the prophets. They're all one. This is so as Christ is all one. Christ is one. We need to act like Christ. People need to look at you and say, you are arrogant. Look over you and say, you know what? You think you're better than I am. And you say, as Christ is, so am I. Romans chapter 14, verse 23. But he who doubts is condemned if he eats, because he does not eat from faith. For whatever is not from faith is sin. Whatever is not from faith is sin. 1 John 3:6-9. We read 1 John 9, but let's look at 1 John 3:9, but let's get 6. Whoever abides in him does not sin. Whoever sins has neither seen him nor knows him. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he's been born of God. So when you have the seed of God, and yeah, I can't be separated from God, God calls me blameless, but you know what? The more you're with somebody, the more you act like somebody, the more you quit doing those things. So does God go around committing adultery? So if you're getting closer to God and God's in your dwelling place and you know that God's there, are you going to be committing adultery?
No.
So you're going to act more holy and righteous on accident than these people who are under the law ever could do on purpose. I've said it 100 times here. I don't commit adultery because the law says don't commit adultery, because I made a promise to my wife. I don't commit adultery because I love my wife. If I didn't love my wife, I would figure some way to get around that. You know, if I love somebody else more than I love my wife, another woman, I would figure some way of manipulating, twisting scriptures, just putting my faith in God away or something. I would do something to try to hide that from my wife and say, well, I'm righteous. Look at me. We're still married. And I have these affairs. And pastors do this all the time. But pastors don't do it because they're sinners. Pastors do it because they don't love their wives. If they loved their wives, they would never do it. You're a liar when you say you did it because the devil told you, because you were a sinner, because we all fall short from the glory of God. We act like Christ because we don't sin. We don't do things bad. And people ask, well, John, you say you don't ever do anything bad. I say, okay, give me a for instance. Accuse me of one of the moral law, of breaking just one of the moral laws. I'm not going to say all the hand washing and the, you know, while a woman goes on her period, she's unclean for 7 days and all this, and if I go out and touch a dead body, or no, the moral law, the Ten Commandments. Show me one that I've broken today. Show me one that I broke yesterday. And convince me that I'm going to break one tomorrow. No, I haven't broke any of those laws. I can say right now, I have not broken any one of the Ten Commandments. Yesterday I didn't break any one of the Ten Commandments, and tomorrow I'm confident I won't break any one of the Ten Commandments. Do I sin in your hypocritical statement of people saying we all sin? No, you're lying. I don't sin. I don't break those moral laws. Okay? But does that mean I can't? Is it possible for me? Yeah, but is it possible for me to commit adultery? Yeah, but before I do that, I have to quit loving my wife. Before I commit one of these moral laws, I have to quit loving Jesus. Right? Don't you have to quit loving Jesus before you can go against Jesus? First John 4:17. This is what everybody ought to have written in their Bible, underlined in their Bible. 1 John 4:17. If you don't believe me that the Bible says this, look it up right now. 1 John 4:17. Love has been perfected among us in this. What's been perfected? Love has been perfected. If it's perfected, is it perfect? It doesn't say love is being perfected. Love has been perfected. It's perfect in this, that we may have the boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. So at the day of judgment, we could come up and say, God, I'm sinless. I'm perfect. I'm blameless. Satan has nothing against me. We could say that. God doesn't have to say that in our behalf. Jesus doesn't have to say that in our behalf. But we have confidence that I could come before God and I say, God, I have no sin in my life. Why? It tells me why. Because as he is, that's capital H in my Bible, as he is, so are we in this world. Verse 18, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. So if I think I might have some unconfessed sin, that if I die with any confessed sin, I may not go to heaven, or if I go to heaven, I might have to go to purgatory, or if I go to heaven and I got this, I may not be getting a good as job or good as position. I'm going to have a fear of it. No, I don't have any fear. No, I don't sin. No, I am blameless, because even as God called Abraham blameless before Jesus shed any blood, and Abram at that time was blameless, I'm blameless, and Jesus cleansed me with his blood. I know this is a rabbit trail, but did you guys realize that Jesus forgave people of sin before he died on the cross?
Yes.
Yeah.
When he healed them, your sins are forgiven.
When he healed the crippled man, mm-hmm. He says, what is easier to say? Stand up and walk, or your sins are forgiven. But I say this so that you know that the Son of Man has the ability to forgive sins on earth as in heaven. I say to you, pick up your mat and walk. He says to the woman that was caught in adultery, go and sin no more. Okay, so if it was possible for us not to sin, why would God tell us not to sin? I mean, if it was impossible for us not to sin, why would God tell us not to sin? And if God couldn't forgive you of all your sins without shedding blood, why would he tell that crippled man his sins were forgiven? Why would God tell Abraham you're blameless? God forgives Abraham all past, present, and future sins. When he made it, and Jesus didn't die for him. Okay. Moving on. We're at that time. How can I take something so simple and easy and make it so complex? Verse 17, and this I say, that the law, which was 430 years later, cannot be annul the covenant that was confirmed before by God in Christ, that it should make the promise of no effect. So how was this confirmed? By Christ, in Christ. Although God made a covenant with Abram and gave his word by passing a burning torch between the pieces of the sacrifice, he confirmed it by Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. We're going to see that in Genesis chapter 15 and chapter 18. Notice, God told Abram that to bring what to bring to the sacrifice, that, man, I said small print, that there would be no error or loophole in this covenant. Additionally, it was God himself that performed and the sanctification of it when he passed the torch between the two pieces of the sacrifice. God did not leave anything up to Abram which might have annulled or voided his covenant with him, the promise to bless all nations through the seed of promise. So it was confirmed through Christ, and God is what God told Abraham what to bring. Why do we take our when we make a will and testament, why do we go to a lawyer? Because we want to make sure we don't make some stupid mistake, right? So if Abraham had a, Abram at the time, if he had had any part in this, there might be a loophole. Satan might say, well, he didn't bring the right animal. No, God told Abram what to bring. God told Abram how to do it. He had to cut the two pieces on the half, and Abram had to watch over and shoo the vultures off. And then God accepted this as a covenant and confirmed it when he passed a torch between it. And that torch is Christ Jesus, because it says he confirmed it in Christ. Okay? But we didn't get the benefits of it until his death. Let me take this point right here, and let's try to open that in Genesis. If we can go to Genesis chapter 15, verse 17, and Genesis 18, 17 through 18, in Genesis 17. So Genesis 15, verses 17 through 18. And it came to pass when the sun went down and it was dark, that behold, there appeared a smoking oven and a burning torch that passed between the two pieces. On the same day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham, saying, to your descendants I will give this land from the river of Egypt to the great river Euphrates. You know, the Jewish people have never established that covenant. They've never had control, ever. Even under Solomon's time, when Solomon, the Jewish people controlled more land during King Solomon's time than any other time, he still, at that time, they did not acquire. From the Nile, all the way to Kuwait, all the way to Saudi Arabia, all the way to the Euphrates, all that, all the way down to that whole big land section, God promised. Have they received that yet? So, but it's still an everlasting promise, right? It's not going to go. We got that land. And who are the Jews? Why do you want to go to Jerusalem? It's my home. That's where I want to go. My heart cries out for Jerusalem because God made me the promise that I get to live there. You know, I don't have a desire to go to the Euphrates River, though, in Saudi Arabia, but that's still part of it. Okay, but how about Genesis 17, verse 7? And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your descendants after you in their generation for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your descendants after you. Jesus was talking to the Pharisees, and they said, if Abraham was your father, you would believe me because he spoke of me. And he said, before that, you're not of your father. Your father's not Abraham, but your father's the devil. So the Jewish people at that time, not all, obviously, but today, those that do not believe in Christ, is their God the God of Abraham? Jesus said, if that was your God, and your God was the God of Abraham, you would believe me. So their God is not the God of Abraham. And they say it is. It's not, according to Jesus. My God is the God of Abraham. My God is the God that passed between these torches. Okay? Now, I know there's many Jews, like Paul was, right? All the disciples were, that God was the God of Abraham. But there's many are called, few are chosen. Most of the Jewish people were not, their God was not the God of Abraham. Their God was some other God, a demonic God. Why? Because they crucified Christ. Why? Because they followed the dictates of the devil. There is the point made that this covenant of blessing was made before the Mosaic covenant, which did not annul the Abrahamic covenant, nor are we today living under a new covenant, but the original that was made 430 years earlier than the second. We were grafted into this covenant so that we might receive eternal life by the grace and the faith of Christ. So, no, Nancy, my genealogy is not of a Jewish genealogy, but I am of the seed. But I was grafted into this, becoming a descendant of Abraham. Romans 4:14. For if those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void and the promise of no effect. So if you receive the promise of Abraham through the law, then the promise is of no effect. It doesn't really make it, because the law only brings forth a curse, not a promise. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. The law never offers eternal life. If you kept the law perfectly, you still would not go to heaven. You still needed Christ. Paul says he kept the law perfectly. He said, in keeping of the law, I am blameless. Romans 8:17. If a child, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified with him. I am an heir of Christ and of God and a joint heir with Christ. So if you're a joint heir, what's that mean? What's it mean to be a joint heir?
Have equal.
You're answering. Yeah. Have equal sharing. So I think most Western states, we have that common married people, it's 50-50. I'm trying to think of the name of it. It's a Spanish name. But like, if you're married for so long, you know, and you're a millionaire.
Common law?
Well, yeah. It's not common law, but it means you're me and I'm you. And we get 50-50. If we got a divorce, it's 50. We're joint heirs. I get it all. If you die, I get it all. If I die, you get it all. Okay? We're joint heirs. So, we get it all. We get everything Christ got. Everything Christ gets, we get. As Christ is, so are we in this world.
Which actually, we don't. In that, what we were talking about, in being married, because if you're both living, then you only get 50-50.
50-50.
But
to get
Christ,
it all.
Christ, he somewhere. Died, we get it all.
We get it. Excellent point. Hopefully everybody heard. When you're married, you only, and you get divorced, you only get 50-50. It takes a death of someone to get it all. So through Christ Jesus, we, death, burial, and resurrection, we get it all. We get 100%. Romans 4:13, for the promise that he would be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. It's the faith of Christ. It's not faith in Christ. This is why the King James is better, even than my beloved New King James. It says this is our faith in Christ. No, it's the faith of Christ. That we get the promises through the righteousness of faith. Faith. Faith is a supernatural something. It's something God has. Human beings are, oh, you of little faith. If you only had the faith of a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, be picked up and go and cast into the sea, right? It doesn't take a whole bunch of faith to do much. But we are little faith. We don't even have the faith of a mustard seed.
And what if we actually have the faith of Christ?
We do. That's
well,
the point.
If we believed it and did it. If the faith of size of a mustard seed could break off physical laws, if we actually lived in what we were promised, what could we do?
Well, this is where I, Nancy, have that problem. Because I get so caught up in what the Bible says. And I say, well, you can't have all these promises if you misinterpret this Bible. Abraham had all these promises and he was bad. But you know, if you understand you have the faith of Christ, then you're like this guy that went to Glad Tidings David Hogan. These people, they got some whacked out theology. Okay, whacked out. Wacky. It seems far-fetched. It may be right, it may be wrong, that's to be seen. But guess what? They're walking in supernatural faith because they realize it's the faith of Christ. You can't even be a pastor unless you've raised three people from the dead? You know, that would disqualify almost every pastor I know.
Yeah.
You know, very few pastors have raised people from the dead.
And the purpose of that, because in their work, they work down in the Aztec Mexico area. And the witch doctors and everything are very, very strong down there. But that is the one thing a witch doctor can't do is give life. So to prove that they are better than the witch doctors, the more powerful, they have to raise people from the dead. The witch doctors can do, I guess,
a lot of stuff.
But they can't give life.
You know, that was part of, also notice that when Moses came to Egypt and talked to Pharaoh, all those plagues,
mm-hmm.
Pharaoh's witches, or what were they called?
Sages or something. Like that.
They could do everything Moses did, except when it came to give life. Mm-hmm. They couldn't duplicate it when it come to make flies. They couldn't duplicate it when it come to make frogs. They couldn't duplicate that, okay? When it came to make life, they couldn't duplicate that. That's amazing. So we need to understand in our brain that we have the faith of Christ. We can do all things. And as Christ is, so are we. If we walk around and say, oh God, please, please, please do this. Most people who talk that way, pray that way, don't get what they're praying for. But those who you like, why do you sit there and say, I command you in the name of Jesus to be God. I say, stand up and walk and be saved. I say, rise from the dead person. I. Well, you can't do that, Christ said. No, the Bible says, you do it. Jesus says, you do it. Jesus never says, go pray for me to raise the dead. Jesus says, you raise the dead. You heal the sick. You cast out demons. The power I give you, you give to other people. Freely you receive, freely you give. Peter said, the power that I have, I now give to you. Stand up and walk. We need to have that understanding that we have the faith of Christ. Closing with verse 18 of Galatians chapter 3. Verse 18, for the inheritance is for if. Him. For if the inheritance is of the law, it is no longer of promise, but God gave it to us gave it to Abraham by promise. My mouth is just so wet. Let me read that again. For if the inheritance is of the law, it is no longer of promise. But God gave it to Abraham by promise. So if the blessings of Abraham were through the law, the inheritance would be wages that we earned, not what Abraham received, making the promise given to Abraham of no effect. Thus, you cannot be under the old covenant and the new at the same time. We cannot earn our way into heaven. We cannot earn our way into power and authority. We cannot receive a special anointing, a special calling, people laying hands on you to be prophets and to be healers. No, God has given that to each and every person. There is not one of the 12 gifts of the Holy Spirit are mentioned. There's more than 12 that are not for every single believer. Every single believer that has been baptized in the Holy Spirit can administer any one of those gifts as needed on command. And if you don't believe me, you need to read your Bible. That's what it says. Okay? Romans chapter 4, verse 14. For if those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void, and the promises of men is made of no effect. Comment. If the law was able to do anything, Christ, when he prayed, my God, Father, take this cup away from me. If there be any other way, take this cup away from me. Well, that means the law cannot bring salvation. That means you do not go to hell because you sinned one time. That means you were going to hell already, and God came and redeemed you from the gates of hell, the grasp of hell, the hold that hell had on you. The law could never, ever set you free. Amen? Okay. Thanks for that thunderous applause.
He said, uh-huh.